for morning service to, in our blue morning worship book, and the service begins on page 4. So we'll just have a moment of quiet as we prepare ourselves to come before God in worship. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, as we confess our sins in penitence and faith. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image, in the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song will we praise our God. Blessed are you, Lord our God, creator and redeemer of all. To you be glory and praise forever. From the waters of chaos you drew forth the world, and in your great love fashioned us in your image. Now, through the deep waters of death, you have brought your people to new birth by raising your Son to life in triumph. May Christ, your light, ever dawn in our hearts as we offer you our sacrifice of thanks and praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. Our first hymn this morning is "Oh, Let the Son of God Enfold You," and can be found on page 20 of the notice sheet or on your screen.
Satisfy your soul. have the things that hold you, and his spirit like a dove will descend upon your life and make you whole. Jesus, oh Jesus, come and fill your lungs. Jesus, oh Jesus, come and fill your lungs. Oh, come and sing this song with gladness as your hearts are filled with joy. Lift your hands in sweet surrender to tears and sadness, give him all your years of pain, and you'll enter into life in Jesus' name. Jesus, oh Jesus,
David. The appointed psalm for today is Psalm 85, page 10 of the notice sheet or on your screen. We say it together. I will listen to what God the Lord says. He promises peace to his people, his faithful servants. But let them not turn to folly. Surely his salvation is near those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven. The Lord will indeed give you what is good, and our land will yield its harvest. Righteousness goes before him and prepares the way for his steps. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And now Amanda's going to bring us our first reading.
Our first reading is from Romans 10, verses 5 to 15. Moses writes this about the righteousness that is by the law. The person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that is by faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the deep, that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you. The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. That is the message concerning faith that we proclaim. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all, and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Amanda. You will find the canticle on page 6 of your worship book. And we say it together. Oh, be joyful in the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with a song. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. For the Lord is gracious, his steadfast love is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Now, Eleanor is going to read our passage from the Gospels.
The Gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 to 33. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and, beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Eleanor. The Benedictus can be found on page 7 of your worship book, and we say it together. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Saviour, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets, God promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors, and to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight all the days of our life. And you, child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break among us, to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Those who have been with us for the last few Sundays will know the diocesan senior clergy have recorded sermons for our use. Today we welcome the Venerable Carol Coslett, the Archdeacon of Chesterfield.
What have you most missed in lockdown? One thing for me has been my regular weekly swim. I'm so glad now that the pools are starting to open again. However, before that, I did manage a quick dip in Lake Windermere and then a trip to Hathersage Pool as soon as it had opened. On both occasions, I sat nervously on the edge, thinking in anticipation of the first step in. On Windermere, it was by a jetty, and as I was gingerly placing my toe in to see how cold it was, hoping to slip in gracefully off a rock, I slipped, and before I knew it, I was immersed, and all I could do was recover myself quickly and swim. As one very kitted up lad in a wetsuit remarked to my daughter, who was also sitting on the jetty watching, said, "That was one way to get in anyway." Hathersage Pool was not quite as bad and wasn't as cold, but still it took an act of determination and faith to slip in off the side and take the first strokes. It was almost as if I was swimming for the first time. It took courage to stay afloat and get the technique back again. But once in, it felt so good and liberating. I wasn't trying to walk on water, but I couldn't help reflect a little on what Peter must have felt in the image we've heard today when he stepped out of the boat onto the lake. And having visited the Sea of Galilee, I know it can be choppy, as was Lake Windermere. Unless one is a strong swimmer and well prepared, it can feel a little like you are drowning, trying to keep afloat with the waves and the wind. But you have to have faith and courage to step in and keep going. And as the saying goes, if you want to walk on water, you have to get out of the boat. And this was the title of a book by John Ortberg, published in 2001. It offers an interpretation of the gospel found in Matthew 14. And the theory goes a little bit like this. Peter had the right idea when he got out of the boat, stepping out in faith. Peter, like all of us, is invited to step out into the storms of life, where Jesus calls us to take courage, leave the safety of the boat and come to him. If we have enough faith in Jesus and keep our focus firmly on him, we will not sink, despite the wind and the waves. If only Peter had not become distracted. When he kept his eyes firmly on Jesus, he could walk on water. When he got anxious and sidetracked from keeping his focus on Jesus, Peter, whose name was Rock, went down like stone. Jesus wants us to be bold in our faith. Jesus wants us to walk on water, dream big, take risks in our lives. And if we can just be faithful enough, we will succeed. The image of walking on water is often linked with the idea of stepping out in boldness, taking a risk. Even business companies, financial consultants are using the term to talk about building their resilience, having courage to present new ideas, and have to have faith in their own abilities. In the situation described in the reading, we find Jesus, his disciples, terrified on the Sea of Galilee. It's certainly not the first time. The disciples know this lake. They're strong fishermen, out at all hours, and no doubt they're good swimmers too. They have experienced the storms of the lake, and you will remember a previous story when Jesus calmed the storm and stilled the wind. Then they were afraid and were rebuked by Jesus for showing little faith. On this day, however, it's not the weather that frightens the disciples. By now they can handle being tossed about by strong winds and waves. No, today they are frightened by something else, an eerie figure walking toward them on the surface of the lake. "It is a ghost," they cry, but Jesus reassures them. "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Alas, these comforting words do not quite satisfy Peter, who seeks further proof of Jesus' identity. "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Jesus agrees, and so Peter does. But after just a few steps, the wind startles him and he begins to sink, crying, "Lord, Lord, save me." Of course, Jesus does save him, but he also asks this sobering question, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" Jesus' question is just as much to us as it was to those fishermen disciples. It might be in the middle of a lake, amidst the storms on the sea. It might be sitting on the edge, and we doubt ourselves. But why do we doubt? Jesus calmed the storm with his voice. He fed 5,000 people with only a few loaves of bread and walked on water. In light of all this, why would we lack faith? Well, one reason is that we are afraid. Like the disciples, sometimes storms pop up in our lives and scare us. That's what storms do. But it's not just the wind and the storms and the rainstorms that scare us. So do the metaphorical storms of our lives. Our present global affairs cause us to fear. Many are very worried about how we will emerge from lockdown. We all fear a recurrence of the pandemic, or a second wave, as they're talking about, and what the autumn will be like. Will we ever get back to our lives like they were before? Other things also concern us, like our relationships with Europe, China, and the US, economic downturns, people's livelihoods, job prospects, or future careers. And then there's our personal illness or terminal diagnosis. These things can all shake us to the core. But in the midst of difficult setbacks, it is not uncommon for us to doubt our faith in God. That's exactly what happened to Peter in today's gospel. All Jesus does is ask why. Like any good teacher, he already knows the answer to the question, but he wants us to know it too. Simply put, it is because we are human. Fear is, quite literally, instinctive. When our lives are in jeopardy, we tend to leave calm and rational thought behind. That's when we often need some assistance in getting back to faith. I've often found that it is through the storms of life that God becomes ever more present, and that the faith is heightened in one's own experience. Whatever crisis we face, if we focus our mind on what is most important, then we can have courage to step out, carry on, and develop that inner strength to ride the storm. My cold dip in Windermere, after the initial panic, focused my mind on swimming and breathing. And that technique led me to relax and eventually enjoy the experience. Jesus uses the question, "Why did you doubt?" to get frightened Peter to focus on what was most important. And in the realms of life's storms, faith is more important than safety. Faith is the foundation of human life, as important as food, water, and shelter. Only after faith is secured can safety add value to living. This is the message of the cross. This is the message of Jesus, his whole life. And faith is what Jesus wants Peter and all of us to focus on when the storms come. Faith is always within our reach, even in the stormiest times of life, when we most doubt our ability to make it through. We can remain faithful to God. We will not always be perfectly faithful. Doubts will creep in. But the important thing is to recover from doubts and return to a place of faith. Our faith is strengthened and sustained by our relationship with God and nurtured by participating in our life in Christ. As we begin to worship again in our churches, we are experiencing new ways of expressing our faith. We are recommitting ourselves, reaffirming our faith, rededicating our lives to God. Our lives will not be the same as we emerge from lockdown, but we can have courage to step out of the boat and continue our journey, proclaiming afresh the good news to a new generation. This is the nature of Christian life, and we do this by refocusing on our faithfulness to the knowledge and love of Jesus, through whom we experience the grace of God. So, whether it is a quick dip in the water or a plunge, I encourage you to take the step of faith that will allow you to walk on water in our new emerging church. God bless you. Amen.
So together we affirm our faith with the words of the Apostle Creed on page 9 of your service book. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated on the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our collect for today can be found on page 10 of your notice sheet or on screen. We pray together. Almighty God, who sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and light of your church, open our hearts to the riches of your grace, that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit in love and joy and peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, your Son Jesus calls us to step out onto the water with him and leave the safety of our boats and to walk towards him in faith. He asks us to join with him in the work he is already doing in our world. Father God, we ask that you look with favour on your church as it proclaims your Son to the world. May the congregations of all our churches in Chelleston and all those who join with us now or later in the day be filled with your Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those killed and injured in the explosion in Beirut. We pray for those searching the debris for survivors and give thanks for the emergency services. We pray for those who have lost their homes their livelihoods, and are now having to cope with so much more, whilst also living through the coronavirus pandemic. Keep those working to relieve the situation in Beirut safe, and bring your comfort to all those impacted by this terrible tragedy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the world you have created. We pray for greater wisdom and responsibility in our stewardship of this earth. We pray for fishermen and seafarers and all who brave the seas to bring us food and trade goods from the furthest reaches of our planet. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, our Saviour, who walks with us on our life's journey. We pray for all who travel with us in our family, among our friends, and within this community. We pray for deepening awareness of our need for one another and of your image in the hearts of everyone we meet, and help us to be vigilant in safety measures to avoid the possibility of spreading the coronavirus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we thank you for the gift of life and pray for those whose lives are troubled by illness, grief, poverty, or injustice. We pray that in the darkness of their suffering and pain, your light will shine to bring them the assurance and hope they need. We remember all those on our prayer lists, and we also remember at this time those known personally to us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we place in your loving keeping all those who have died. Alan Keep, Dora, Fred Phillips, Audrey Harrison, Greta Eardley, Brian Cripps, Val Cole, Brian Johnson, and all those killed in the Beirut disaster. We pray that we too may show in our lives the promise of heaven's love, joy, and peace, and we ask for your comfort and peace to be on all who mourn. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, we thank you for your promise to hear our prayers. Strengthen our faith in that promise so that our lives might proclaim your love, mercy, and goodness made visible in the life of your Son, Jesus Christ. And when the winds and waves get high and threaten to overwhelm us, help us to remember Jesus' words. Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Gathering our prayers and praises into one, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our second hymn this morning, At the Name of Jesus, is on screen or page 20 of your notice sheet.
At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess Him, King of glory now. 'Tis the Father's pleasure we should call Him Lord, who from the beginning was the mighty Word.
Sing the grace to each other, and while David is still at the keyboard, does anybody have a birthday today or in the coming week? We do know that Shirley has a very big birthday on Thursday. Is there anybody else we need to add? No? Okay then, David, please can we sing happy birthday to Shirley for her big 90th birthday, if you don't mind me saying, Shirley, on Thursday.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Shirley, happy birthday to you.
Thank you very much.
We hope you have a lovely day. So we're now going to sing the grace to each other. David. The love of the Lord Jesus draw you to Himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in His service. the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those whom you love, and keep you safe this day and forevermore. Amen. Go in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.